Jason, come in. It's so good to see you.
You too, Professor. Thanks for meeting with me.
No problem. Have a seat. You said over the phone you're really frustrated at work and needed some advice. What's going on?
As you know, Prof, I'm responsible for the continuous improvement at our organization. But almost every change I suggest gets shot down. I used to love my job, but the resulting disharmony with my coworkers is now so bad that I'm actually considering a new job offer. I don't know if I should accept this job or hang in there.
This sounds serious, Jason, but I'm a little confused. Surely people resisting change is nothing new to you, right? I mean, people have probably been resisting change since the invention of the wheel.
That is abysmal.
I feel a lot like that guy. We both had ideas shot down that we thought could make things better, faster, cheaper, and easier for everyone.
I've always been interested in why we all sometimes make changes that are bad for us, or why we sometimes resist making changes that we probably know will be good for us. Let's use your specific case to try to answer these two questions.
Sure, but how do we start?
We can use Benjamin Franklin's pro-con method, which he first described in a letter he wrote to a friend in 1772, who had a dilemma similar to yours.
What advice did he give his friend?
Franklin told his friend that he couldn't help him decide what to do, but could share his own method for how to make such difficult decisions. He suggested taking a page and drawing a line in the middle. On the top part, you write the pros or upside of the change, and below, the cons or the downside of the change. To reach a final decision, you check whether or not the arguments for the change outweigh the arguments against the change.
I've already done this, Prof. Maybe not on paper, but in my head, and I still come out stuck.
Not writing it down is your first mistake. We struggle to make decisions when trying to process a lot of opposing ideas in our head. So why don't you start by actually writing down the pros and cons of taking the new job?
Do you think these are okay?
Yes, they're good. But do you notice how few cons you have compared to your long list of pros? This is the other advantage of writing it down. It can help us spot confirmation bias that could be clouding your judgment.
You're right. There must be a few more cons. Otherwise, this would be an easy decision. But Prof, what do I do now? I have the same number of pros and cons, and they all look important.
Yes, that's one of the limitations of Franklin's pro-con method. As you can imagine, decision sciences have advanced a little over the last 250 years. Dr. Ellie Goldratt, author of The Goal and creator of Theory of Constraints, developed the ChangeMatrix to help overcome this limitation.
How does this method work?
It builds on Franklin's method by asking us to consider the pros and cons of not changing. This provides additional insight for either making a good decision or better understanding the causes of a bad decision.
Okay, but aren't they just opposites of each other?
Not necessarily. To clearly differentiate the four assumptions or forces that impact our decisions, Goldratt used a simple story. Suppose you're standing at the base of a mountain, and you have to decide whether or not to climb it. Climbing the mountain represents the change we are considering. On top of the mountain is a pot of gold. This represents our assumption about the pros, or future upside, of making a change.
So what are the cons, or future downside?
Climbing up the mountain takes a lot of effort and can be quite risky. You may fall down and break your legs, or even your neck. The effort or cost of making the change, and the risk of failing, is represented by two crutches.
What represents our assumptions about the pros and cons of not changing?
An alligator swimming towards us at the base of the mountain represents the current downside of not changing. If we don't run up the mountain, we'll be eaten. And the longer we wait, the bigger the risk.
I suppose my alligators would be the disharmony I have with my coworkers, and that I sometimes take these frustrations home. And what represents the upside of not changing?
The positive of the status quo is represented by a mermaid. She represents what we're afraid to lose if we change, because we can't take her with us up the mountain. So Jason, what are you afraid to give up? What's your mermaid?
You know, I do love my current job. And working so close to home, I get to spend more time with my kids each day. Also, I hate failing. If I quit my job, I'll feel like a failure.
Now for the test. Stand back and look at each of the boxes as objectively as you can. And ask yourself, is this really true? Is that really important to me?
I wonder if I've been exaggerating the size of my alligators, or the pot of gold. So, Prof, Do you think this answers your question? That exaggerated frustrations or expectations can sometimes cause us to make bad changes?
Yes, I think you're right, Jason. Very good. But let's see if we can answer my other question.
Yes. Why were my coworkers resisting my proposed changes? So, how will we answer that?
We can also use Goldratt's ChangeMatrix to understand what is likely causing your coworkers' resistance. But let's first review the decision process steps we've already completed. Step 1 is to define the problem that is putting pressure on us to change. Step 2 is clearly verbalizing your conflict in dealing with the problem by listing all of your pros and cons of changing and not changing. In Step 3, we create the change matrix for the ones we are blaming for causing our problem.
This should be easy. I blame my coworkers for resisting most of my changes. The change I want them to make is to actively support my proposed changes.
That's good, but let's be more specific. Which of your proposed changes did you really think they would support, but didn't?
Probably the best example was my recommendation for everyone to stop multitasking. I'll explain. Multitasking has been a serious problem that was hurting our productivity, and causing many projects to be late and over budget. However, despite showing my coworkers all the research of how multitasking negatively impacts their productivity and quality of work, many still continue multitasking. I don't get it.
Yes, I'm familiar with the research. This will be an interesting example to investigate further.
So, what should I write in the not change and change boxes for my coworkers' change matrix?
In the not change box, you write the action or non-action of the person you believed caused your problem. And in the change box, you write the action you want them to take, which would have prevented your problem.
Okay. Many of my coworkers continue to multitask, even after agreeing that it's bad for them and the organization. And I want these coworkers to actively support the change to stop multitasking.
Good. Now tell me about their pot of gold and alligator.
The pot of gold is completing more high-priority projects faster and cheaper. The alligator is the pressure we face due to most projects being late, over budget, or not delivering their full scope.
Jason, look at what you wrote. Aren't these the alligator and pot of gold for the organization rather than for your coworkers? This is a common mistake we make when trying to convince people to make a change. We focus on what's in it for the organization, not always on what's in it for the people whose support we're trying to gain. So try to put yourself in their shoes. What do you think they will say was their pot of gold and their alligator for stopping multitasking?
I guess they would say that the upside for them will be less stress and actually getting more work completed, because they can focus on one thing at a time.
Yes, that sounds better. And what about their alligator? Is there really a major downside if they don't stop?
Maybe not. I think my coworkers would say their alligator is the constant risk of layoffs, because we're not meeting milestones, and maybe just feeling so overwhelmed because they're working on so many things at the same time.
Very good. But now for the more challenging boxes. What do you think are the fears that are blocking your coworkers from stopping multitasking? Their crutches and Mermaid.
Well, we've been conditioned that the ability to multitask is a valuable skill. Their crutches could be the fear that if they stop multitasking, they might be viewed as incompetent. Others might be worried that it will just take too much effort to really break the habit.
Very good. And what about their Mermaid? What is the upside of multitasking that they're afraid to give up?
I'm not sure what they will say, but for me, when I multitask, I don't have to tell anyone no or not now. That can be very uncomfortable, especially if it's to your boss or an important customer. Wow, this has given me a lot of new insights. I hope this also helped answer your question about why we all sometimes resist good changes.
Yes, I think I got my answer. We probably don't pay enough attention to the exaggerated fears of loss and risk that people have when they feel pressured to change.
Now I understand why so many of my well-intentioned, but probably half-baked ideas were resisted.
And you used to think that your coworkers were just being ignorant or being negative, right?
Yeah.
Okay, Jason, let's summarize what we've discovered so far. The Change Matrix is a simple analysis tool that can help us understand how exaggerated fears can cause us to resist good changes, and how exaggerated frustrations can cause us to make bad changes. Of course, some fears and frustrations are very helpful, and we should keep these. But when we have exaggerated fears and frustrations, they can be harmful. And Jason, remember, don't try doing it all in your head. Follow the 3 steps. Step one is clearly defining the problem that is pressuring you to change. Step two is writing your change matrix to expose the conflict you face in how to deal with the problem, including your assumptions about the upside and downside of changing versus not changing. And then step three is to do the same for those you are blaming for causing your problem. Then, share your analysis with them to get their help and input in order to find a win-win.
Thank you so much, Prof. I think that following these steps will give us new insights and restore harmony among all our stakeholders.
I'm excited to see how this turns out for you. I've been testing a new method called the ProConCloud, which deals with more complicated issues. But let's save that for another time.
That sounds like a plan. Thanks again, Professor. If you have an important decision you are facing, or want to understand what may have caused you or someone else to make a bad decision in the past, why not try out Goldratt's Change Matrix process to tell your story? Simply follow the link below to download a Google Doc with a template of the three steps and get started right away.